So boys, we're going back in time 10 years to when I had hair, the Barney army dominated the shed. Tiggy was in something like his third year of 25 years of being the first 15 captain, and Tubby Brown was thin. Pikey wore NFL cleats. The turtle was in his prime. Luke McCann, looking 50, was still in his 20s, and Joe Edwards was playing despite actually being 50 years old. Ed Stewart was still vaguely athletic. Gregsy was still some young whippersnapper. Sinky and Niv were the Chuckle Brothers. Stu Pat still liked to make an appearance off the bench now and then. Dave Rattray added some much needed pace to a pretty much paceless backline. Gav Douglas, if he could be arsed, could be absolutely magnificent. Mike Campbell kept tempo high from 9, and Harry's hamstrings and knees held up, he was deadly. Spam on his massive forehead was making his debut for Accies, and the squad in general was just full of legends. Accies was just a brilliant place to be, and presiding over it all were Jim Rennick and Ian Barnes. Tell me about Barney. What did you think of Barney when you first met him?
Your thoughts when I say the name Ian Barnes.
I couldn't understand him.
Didn't understand a word he said, and I think he hit me about 3 times in one session.
I had no idea what he was saying. I didn't understand him, no.
Still couldn't understand a fucking word he said either, to be honest. Like, there would just be spit coming out.
Bad-mouthed everyone. Told us we were terrible.
I played under him for 5-6 years. As a back, never taught me anything.
Barney used to beast the hell out of us.
Suits! Mugs!
Bunch reverses, the scarf.
I remember coming down to Rayburn Place and being at St Andrews, where I've been pretty much the roughest speaking guy in the whole squad by a long way, and come down to Rayburn and Barney's there talking quasi-English, swearing a lot, a scarf mysteriously wrapped around his neck.
The figure of 8, up the tunnel.
You used to go through it, and if you just saw a wee gap, you just jump through it, you literally launch yourself through it like Superman. And I remember once, I think it was Marshy who stepped over, it was Ed Stott actually. Stott, he stepped over this bag and he went, "Sir,
for fuck's sake, Ed!"
Pulls the ball down. He goes, "Why are you fucking blah, 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 blah." He goes, "The only difference here is if you stand on him, I want you to stand on everyone. The only difference is if you stand in the opposition, you're damn the studs, you're damn the boys."
Brutal. If you tried to describe it to rugby players nowadays, they'd give up. You just, 4 guys either side holding rucking shields, and you had to drive up the middle of that tunnel, and their job was to smash you and hurt you. And then the rucking drills, and the only difference in practice was that you didn't turn the stud.
I remember many a trainings, mainly in the physio room with Laura, just making sure that I didn't have to go out there and hit tackle bags.
So you were to ruck over, and if you tried to step over the guy on your team placing the ball back, he would stop the session to berate you. You had to stand on him, but just don't turn the stud because he's in your team. Unbelievable.
Like a lot of these things in my life, you know, I was never going to let the bastards beat me. So all those Tuesdays in the pissing rain, getting shouted at and sweared at, I sort of kept on coming back for more.
We did have a phenomenal forward pack that year. And he was certainly not one for getting the ball out wide.
Towards the end of the time with Barney, I actually got on with him really well. I respected him. I'm definitely a better player because of him.
Ach, I like Barney. Like, if he took his shit, he was actually a really good lad. If you got speaking to him, could absolutely eat his way through pints, which was an extraordinary thing to witness.
But it made us a hard, fit, physical pack.
It was certainly a little bit harder from hitting a 20 bags and 20 pads and going underneath his scarf.
The one with the scarf where you had the pad down, you had to hold your hands, which means you'll get your hands all crumpled on. You had to go under the scarf, which meant the shield would just basically hit your neck and it would just bend everywhere when you were going under it, while he was basically shouting at you, "It's shite, it's shite, it's shite."
It was the worst drill I've ever heard of in my life. I mean, there's no way you would get an award. Couldn't be a coach and dish out the hoik scarf. He would hold pads at either side, and his sole aim of the scarf was to choke you to death. You had to go under it. If you got caught in it, he would pull it tight, he would yank it and get you.
When I once got more saliva on me than Beethoven, the big dog rolling his face around. I went too high and got grabbed by the collar.
What about Rennick? Tell me about Rennick.
Inspirational. One of the, if not the best backs coach, best stroke coach I've ever had in my life.
The wee bald man that loves a peeve, loves a woman, loves to live life.
Well, he believed in you for a start. Second thing, he had a vision. He was a realist, but yet an opportunist, and yet an optimistic. And he just made you feel like when Freddie Flintoff said, you put on the shirt with the three lions, you're like Superman, you're going out, you've got a body of steel. That's what Jim Rennick made you feel like. You know, he believed in you that much that when you went out onto the park, you thought you could beat anyone and any man. And that's a good coach in my book.
No, he was sort of the softer side that Barney didn't have. You know, Barney was all out bosh. Jim sort of pulled him back, and Jim was the brains of the operation.
Love Rennick's stories. You know, it was always good to get him on a bus. Likewise, he still had, you know that sense of humour. You know, he was someone that, you know, I think had the respect of all the guys. You know, given him, you know, he's just a legend of the game. But yeah, always had a lot of time for Jim. That doesn't mean he didn't give me a lot of shit as well, but yeah, good times. Stop running out of the line and all that sort of stuff. But again, I won't even try to put on the accent. But yeah, top bloke.
This afternoon's Premier 2 clashes at historic Raeburn Place, scene of the very first international match ever between Scotland and England in 1871, but it won't look like this for much longer. Massive developments going on at Edinburgh Accies are up there, vying for promotion to Premier 1, lying second in the table.
It was the Newton-Stewart game that I remember, because we didn't really give the cup much credit at the time, because you don't really expect to go anywhere as a P2 team, and that was the worst conditions I've probably ever played in.
It was, but it was kind of a nice day going there, and it started raining a bit, and when we got there it was, you know, it was probably one of the most rural pitches I've ever come across, and that the pitch was slightly inclined and it was pouring with rain when we got there, and they were like shooing sheep off the pitch at one corner. I remember they had to get them off. And it was, you know, the weather made it a very entertaining game in terms of what we were coming to look to do.
It was just coming down sideways, hail hitting us in the face. And I remember I went and spoke to the referee and I said, we're going to have to go off the pitch here, we can't see. And the Newton-Stewart captain went mental and he goes, oh, southern softies, you big poof, you this and that. And then the hail was coming in and I couldn't even see the ref in front of me.
Oh. Fuck, it was just honestly, you know, having spent a few years in Aberdeen playing as well, that was probably the low moment of my life.
And the game obviously turned out being, it wasn't even 10-man rugby, it was probably 8-man rugby at best. And Kevin Gartside at fullback, obviously he didn't get to see much of the ball, and I remember him telling me after the game that he actually peed on himself to keep warm at fullback.
At one point we had a fight, and someone pulled, old ice hockey style, pulled my top over my head, and I was just giving it one of these, connected with no one, rattled about 20 punches in my face, just like that. Just remember pulling my shirt down and just seeing Joe Edwards just side to side, like someone had put a stick of wood on his shoulders like that, and he literally just gave it doof, doof, doof.
And I think we won it with Gav Douglas at the back of a driving mall.
5-0.
That's basically how we scored the majority of our tries.
I actually went off with 10 minutes to go with mild hypothermia, I think.
Well, and I broke my thumb, and it must have been about 5 minutes to go, and they pulled me off and put Jamie Parker on, who had just been substituted earlier. So I went in, I was like, game's done. You know, we won, Gav Douglas, middle of a ruck. You know, a good ruck's better than a bad pass. Jumped inside, and I was like, I'll have a shower now. Jumped in the shower, used all the hot water.
I remember, and then the showers afterwards, they weren't really working. There was like three showers that were just dribbling out water. And we were all kind of huddling in there, just trying to get warm again.
So all these boys came in shivering away. No hot water left. I'm like, just drying myself like that. Steam
coming off your skin.
My thumb's a bit sore, but jeez. This is good, bad. and then came home from that and got pretty loose on the sky back up the road.
They were a league below or two, I think, under us. It was just confidence in what we did, and they actually started winning. But there was no panic, you know, there was just, you know, taking the stride.
Two games, we played against Murrayfield, but we absolutely humped them both games, and I can't remember the scoring, but I think just we put them to the sword. That was probably the big thing. We didn't hold off, we just kept going. And I think you could have probably at 40, 50 points just gone, actually, we'll just slow it down.
And the game panned out well. I think the Rat scored probably a hat trick, you know, it was just feed the Rat. You know, you got him on his right foot and you basically left everyone dying, and it was a good pitch, it was a hard pitch.
No, I think that showed we were a good team and kept the momentum going both between the league games and then the cup games. We just kept that momentum going, which was good.
I actually, in preparation for this, I actually read a few old articles, and you know, I think the one that comes to mind is the Curry game, who were league champions that year by some margin as well. And
no one gave us a chance, but I always went into every game thinking, we've got a chance.
You know, I think we were all massively psyched up, and not particularly because it was Curry or what Curry had come and doing their features. It was just, we were really starting to hit our stride and sort of, you know, the team culture and what we did and what we did very well.
They were cup and league champions previous year. I think they won the league that year.
They absolutely spanked us in the first 20, 30 minutes. We were down about 20-0, three tries. Ali Warnock, who's over here in Australia now, is looking balder than I am, and I've given him a bit of grief recently around old Gav Douglas, but he was in the Edinburgh system as a pro at the time, and mate, Gav just showed him up. He played one of the best games I've seen from a 5-8. I don't like to give, having lived with Gav Douglas, I don't like to give him too many raps, because I've never seen anyone beat so much in their life, live the most unhealthiest of lifestyles. But, you know, he just has that ability, you know, those few games a year just to make something special. And fortunately for us, that one for Curry, and also later on against Boroughmuir, I remember him being just exceptional at 10.
So we're staring down the barrel, but Paddy Cooper goes off. I think he goes off. We're struggling a wee bit.
I've got a memory of coming on the pitch. I think he dislocated his shoulder, and Ed's behind him, and Ed goes, "Don't you fucking dare. Don't you fucking dare." So Sinky's arm's down like this, and he goes, "Don't you dare think about leaving this pitch." Sinky goes, "Oh, I'll be fine. Goes into a scrum with his dislocated shoulder. And he goes, nah, it's done. Ed just stands up out of the scrum, he goes, "You're dead to me."
I don't think it was that. I think the banter, "You're dead to me," was more after the game.
Well, you came on, Peter.
I came on.
You were one of the differences. Peter, the difference Burns.
We scored.
I call you.
A try from a rolling maul.
Sure.
Pikey scored.
Yeah, the big man.
I think at that point Curry maybe just got a little bit complacent, thought, "Here we go." And we just crept back in, and we just played really hard. And I think that's where the team came together.
What do you remember about our super sub, Gordy Reid?
Oh, Gordy was a class act. Class act the whole season, I thought he was. And Gordy that game, he was phenomenal. He came on and he actually probably added an extra punch of, you know, of zest to the game. You know, he was just carrying balls. I remember people were flying with the high tackles to him. They might have not been high, he was so small, you know. And he would just duck under them and the arms would just fly over and he'd just keep going for it, you know. He could throw a dart in the line, and he was good in the scrum as well. You know, Joe moved to prop, and Gordy was a good guy. He gained a lot of respect, not only from me, I think, from the whole team.
Dave Rattray, remember that?
Silky legs.
Unbelievable.
And, you know, that David Rattray try at the end, over that bald cant, that winger, Caldwell, I think his name is, still remember him. So, mate, to see David Rattray just slice through about 4,000 players and score that try was something that I'll remember for a long time.
It's just one of those games where you get the momentum with you, it's under the lights, and everything just comes together. And I think that set the whole thing going, was just getting the momentum coming off the back of that. And it's just, afterwards, there's never a question of our boys going out, they're not going out. It's just after every game.
That whole season was about playing hard but getting really pissed after that as well. Ollie Miller is club president. You knew if you won, you were going in the changing rooms with cases of beer in there. We'd work our way through Stockbridge and up into town.
That was just what we did. It's like nowadays you go, oh, you might go for a pint afterwards or whatever. It was just...
went to Wiggins. Massive
80 minutes done. Everyone's going out en masse and it's just absolute party time. We just didn't have any other concerns other than rugby and enjoying ourselves afterwards.
So we went to Wiggins and Mike Campbell had his first date with his bird at the time and he brought her along. So we went to Wiggins and it was three thieves and we're like, right, what do you want? I'll have a bottle of rum. What do you want? I'll have a bottle of rum as well. So we literally stacked up the bottles of Morgan's and put a pitcher of Coke in front of us. We got in wee alcoves afterwards and we just drank, got some food, and then at the end of the night we're like, right, let's head on elsewhere. We're like, how much would you? And they're like, nah, we'll waive it. You guys have a good night. It's good.
Hoik was probably the first game that I thought the moment, you know, we thought it too much.
Well, obviously the fact we had Marshy, Jamie Parker, Gav, Barney Coach, Jim Rennick, who's the other guy that was Joe, and then there's the guy used to be the referee, like the old guy, remember? Kenny McCartney, was it?
Yeah.
So he was. So it was basically the whole week build up. I think, you know, Barney and that probably overhyped it a bit. He got a bit more excited and then got the whole team going.
Hoik, because of a lot of Hoik guys playing, obviously Barney and Jim, and, you know, there were another couple of guys, the Crab, is it, that used to do touch? You know, they all constantly kind of drilled it into your head, you know, Hoik is this and Hoik is that. And I think that kind of got to a lot of guys. And I don't think Hoik were having a particularly good season. I think it was the usual Hoik, certainly since I've been here in Scotland, that just kind of, you know, a nugget team to play, you know, hard, good players, good at the breakdown, and just, you know, a lot of, you know, back chat.
I remember Barney giving a pre-game talk and I blurted out in the middle of it, I was like, I don't care what this, but I don't think we're going to take it to them. And we came out, we used to come over from the old clubhouse and I remember they ran over and as I was coming out I was like, fuck it, let's walk and leave them on the pitch. And we walked over slowly and then we got on the pitch and the crowd was massive. I remember the crowd being huge and the crowd sort of dragged us on.
Down here we were building momentum, Rayburn Place, we just felt like we could beat anyone. We were starting to get really good crowds as well. So I remember Hoik game, you know, the big buses of people bust up from Hoik, you know, all around here was great.
And I would say in other circumstances that game would have been easier, but I think we thought the process too much. I think Barney probably thought it too much as well. His eagerness to obviously beat them. And we got caught and it was a tight game, I remember. It was a tight, tough game.
You had a game plan, you played three or four phases that you knew where you should be. And then we moved to boots and saddles rugby where the forwards just went from ruck to ruck, smashing the shit out of anything that moved. And I actually quite enjoyed it. It was just so unstructured, it brought rugby back to its basics where it's basically a momentum game. You just smash into the gain line and then get the forwards over the top and you get them going backwards, and when they're going backwards enough, that's when you dish it out. It brought rugby back to a real simple level, but the way that we were able to execute it that year in particular, it was pretty unstoppable.
And I just remember just taking the two of them up front. Anything they did, we just slammed into them. Not in ones, but in twos and threes. Like it was literally just like cheap shots, go for it, have a go.
With Barney, my game was just to hit things. Just smash it up, smash rocks, smash people. But it suited you as a young guy. Physical, lots of exuberance and energy.
You know, Gab, those games, he was so influential for all the team. I don't think people realise how he could actually bring the whole thing down to where we wanted to just, you know, pressure him to line out there, or suddenly it's a half a break that he creates, or he, you know, that would rub off people. And Hoik was a tough game, and tough game for Gav playing against him, but that was probably the first time certainly playing with another team against Hoik. I'm not sure, I've never asked him that, but it was tough. I would say it was probably the toughest game of the season.
And then we didn't think we would really win. And then I remember being midway through the game and just like, we got it.
Mike Campbell
dominated them. Yeah. Mike Campbell came up here, brilliant break off the back, scored. Tubby obviously giving away a try earlier on by getting charged down. Willie Blackbox scored. And
charged down specialist.
There's another one to think of what was to come, like giving away points in the cup run.
Like the final. Tubby's, what's he up to? We haven't got there yet.
We're going to get there.
It was a cagey game. We won it, but I think we could have done better.
Do you remember like coming into the games against Hoyt, like, and Barney's watering the pitch beforehand? It's quite a tight game, and then we played Boroughmuir. We won the league the following year, and they were flying that year. Absolutely,
yeah, they had a really strong team. Ben Fisher, Angus Martin, really good team. Cusseter, all these guys.
But the Boroughmuir game, mate, it was. Again, they've been a phenomenally successful, you know, Edinburgh team in P1 for many years.
And again, everyone wrote us off, but I was going into these games and never doubting, never thought, oh, we've done well, that'll do. Just, and I always had that mindset all the way through, even when we were in Prem 1. You'd go out and today we can do this. I always looked around and thought we had enough there. We always had that spirit.
Boroughmuir, for me, we just, after the Hoyt game, we got back to that mentality, and it was just like, you know, they obviously had come through beating a couple of big sculpts as well. I think they beat Watsonians maybe on the way, in a couple of big Prem 1 teams. We were doing well in Prem 2 still, and you know, we didn't think about it, we didn't overanalyze it. God, Barney didn't analyze any opposition anyway, so, but we certainly didn't think about them. And the game came, and it was just that spirit again. We knew what we were doing. We knew the confidence was there in the team and the pack. We were fit, certainly considerably fitter than what I am now at the time. So we could back ourselves with a lot of things, you know, that probably some Prem 1 teams weren't expecting too much from us.
Massive crowd.
A couple of busloads up, and it was just sort of carnival atmosphere. It was really good that we got those games at home, the quarterfinal and the semi, because it had been years since there had been any sort of crowd at Raeburn.
One of the big things with Boroughmuir was we'd heard, and whether it was one of these urban legends, that they'd already got their cup final t-shirts printed.
Yeah, Boroughmuir, they were a hard test, but it was just one of those days everything came off.
You know, we just absolutely went for it.
You just have those games in any sport, you have your day when every pass goes to hand, every bounce of the ball, we absolutely rolled them.
And we just kept attacking.
Gav Douglas was absolutely sensational in that game. Like, he'd been good all the year. Like, when he turned it on, he was unbelievably good.
It suited with such a big pack, having a 10 who's got an enormous boot. And he knew that pitch, and he could just play the corners. When we built a bit of pressure up, he could just drop back in the pocket and nail the drop goal. He's a class act.
To be honest, I think he just looked outside of him, see me, and was just like, fuck this. I'm having a drop guard.
thing, and I remember Jamie as well, because I think he was carrying a bit of an injury, I think, at the time, in his calf or his ankle.
Ankle, yeah.
And the way Jamie just broke off rocks off the scrum, the tackles he put in, the work rate, he was a really, really quality player.
We went into the half and we just blew him off the park, and they couldn't come back. It was a phenomenal day. And all I remember, again, similar to the Curry and the Hoyt game, is I kind of remember the nights out afterwards more than I do the games, and sitting at Wiggins and just buying bottles of spice and just getting absolutely stuck into it, thinking that we were, honestly, probably the best rugby team in the world.
It was my first season at Hawks, having just moved back through to the West, for work and away from the mighty Accies, so it was all pretty new to me. To be fair to Hawks, they had been the winners of Premier One for the past three seasons in a row, from 2003 through to 2006. That was quite an achievement, and a first for a team from Glasgow. Just to be 100% clear, I had absolutely no part in any of that success, long before my time. In the run of the cup final, we had just one defeat in 9 matches. The defeat was to Hoyt at Mansfield Park, and the other matches included a 14-all draw with Glasgow Warriors in a training match at the end of March under the floodlights at Old Annie's Land. As the Hawks Cup run progressed, I was obviously keeping a keen eye on the progress of Accies, who were dominating Premier 2 that season and were on an impressive cup run. Each Sunday morning, I used to wake up, get the papers, and I would always see that Barney was talking up his side and the fact that he was working with the best pack of forwards that he'd ever had. Whether to believe Barney's chat or not, I reckoned he probably was onto something special. The results were speaking for themselves on the pitch, and I remember feeling, frankly, a little bit left out that I wasn't a part of that anymore. There just wasn't the same intensity at Hawks. Thank fuck.
Going to Murrayfield, the it's a big thing on their end to begin with Marsh's wedding.
Yeah, that whole thing with Marsh's wedding was hilarious. He moved his wedding to the morning, got a helicopter organised by Pikey up to Fetties, and a police escort across Edinburgh to Murrayfield was absolutely unbelievable.
Yeah, so talk to me, when did they give you the call about coming over from Barcelona?
I got an email before I got a call, so I got an email from him saying, Ed, you know, we are on a bit of a cup run, which obviously I was aware of because I was in touch with you guys the entire time. Would you be prepared to fly over and sit on the bench, basically? Eventually, obviously, I couldn't refuse it, so I sat on the bench for, came on in the quarter and the semi, and then obviously the final as well. And it's one of the best things I've ever done. It was a great footnote on my Accies career.
I remember turning up for the match at Murrayfield. It was all new to me. I'd never been to a cup final before, as had none of you guys. But not new to the guys round about me, you know. They'd been to many's a cup final, 1-2 prior to that match. I remember getting off the coach as we arrived at Murrayfield, and one of the random props at Hawks said to me, "This is shite, isn't it?" Asked him what he was talking about, and he said they used to have bagpipes playing when you got off the team bus at these finals. They don't bother with that any days, and they're trying to kill the club game. He was a complete fucking fanny.
I remember going into the dressing room at on the final, and obviously Jim Rennick's name was there. You know, they got the names around on the lockers. So Jim was there as a classic, and Barney's like, "Where's my name?" You know, and I think someone yelled out, "You only played 10 games or something," and he fucking wasn't happy. So that was the start of the day, and it didn't get much better for us after that, but he was walking around looking for his name, and it wasn't there. It was, anyway, funny shit.
It's the final of the National Cup at Murrayfield, contested between Edinburgh Accies and Glasgow Hawks. Accies promoted from Premier 2 to Premier 1 this season, but they've dumped three Premier 1 sides out of the cup on the way to Murrayfield, so Hawks know that they're in for some kind of game this afternoon if they're to lift the cup again.
Certainly for me, maybe it might not have been true for everyone, but getting to Murrayfield and finally getting an actual in the cup, not won the Shield a few years earlier, but maybe playing the occasion rather than the game, but maybe a bit overawed on the occasion. Like, we had to work really hard for every point that we scored in the final. They were much more fluid and looked much more dangerous in attack than we were.
Early on, they showed exactly what the game plan was, spreading the ball wide, and a crunching tackle there by David Rattray on Stevie Gordon showed that Accies' defence was going to be one to be reckoned with.
The general thought was that Barney's forwards would come out and try to batter Hawks up front. But that wasn't the Accies' game plan early doors. They had a talented backline with the likes of Gav Douglas and Paul Loudon featuring, and instead Accies threw the ball around. But ultimately, it was the forwards that still did the damage.
20 minutes gone, and who had the ball? Nobody was quite sure. You watch the big man at the back though, he knows exactly where he's going. Ed Stewart ripping the ball out and crashing over the Hawks' line for the opening score.
Now the game started, for me the game started like every game. You know, I thought we were not being blown over by a supposedly better team than us, being Prem 1 and us Prem 2. We scored early, I remember Gav having a couple of, you know, goals, a drop goal. We were comfortable, we were looking to score the point. Tough to say, but I think for me, really, the big turnover point was probably the yellow card, which I got.
Even John Fitzpatrick couldn't find a way through. But finally, it was just too much for the Accies defence, And this time, Ed Stewart really paid the price. Let's have a wee word, said Peter Allen. And that wee word is yellow.
Yeah, it was a tough one with Ed because he brought that physical presence that we wanted and needed in our pack. But it was a wee bit of a sort of liability as well in terms of, are you going to be down to 14 men? And when he was on the pitch, he made a difference, but you know, quite a lot he did get simmed. And I think he just got a reputation with the referees as well. So I think actually a lot of the time towards the end of the season, he was probably quite harshly penalised. But by that point, he'd got a bit of a reputation for being on the line.
Hindsight will tell anyone, you know, do you want to go for a 50-50 5 metres from your line? Well, in my book, you do. And unfortunately, the referee claimed it was hands in the ruck, so he gave me a yellow card. And the rest was history.
That was a big, big blow to Accies. Not just that it gave Mike Adamson the simplest of 3 points for Hawks, but they'd lost one of the big, dynamic, driving men from their pack.
You know, I came off 8-0 up. They scored an intercept try, was it just before half-time? And, you know, you could feel it, you know, like a grasp of sand. You could feel it starting to get out of your finger.
It's pressure rugby. It's not international standard rugby or anything, but as a cup final, as amateur rugby goes, it's about as big as it gets. And sometimes the pressure gets the people.
Into injury time, Mike Adamson looking to take the game into half-time, missed his touch. But oh dear, Ross Brown looking for support, flipped the ball up, and who was there to his horror? It was John Fitzpatrick, and the Hawks flanker from 50 yards out made absolutely no mistake, going all the way. What a score to get.
Before halftime, we would have went, it was the last play of the half, and we would have went into the halftime break, a few points up. And I was on the other side of the field, as I usually am, just, you know, parking around. And I just looked up, and I didn't know if he fumbled it or kicked it or passed it. It was fucking hilarious. But at the time, I just went, what the fuck?
I remember at halftime, just trying to plead with everyone to show what we could do, because I felt we were letting ourselves down with the intercept. Stupid things, we almost caught in the lights a wee bit on the day, and I just thought if we could rouse it for one effort and get that momentum going, I thought we could still turn it around.
Rory Kerr finding Gordon McFadden, knocking players out of the way, setting it up, and Sinclair again. Adamson, lovely ball out to Murray Strang, and Strang inside ball. And it was Ali McClay who was in support to touch down under the posts for what proved to be a crucial try.
The number 8, Ali McClay, he was a good rugby player, he was more of a centre, but remember he was scoring a try and he was holding the ball out behind him, and that really got my gut. I hate people showboating like that. And I spent most of that game running around just trying to take that guy's head off. I think I must have tackled him about 10 times. I was just absolutely livid that he did that to us in a cup final.
And Accies knew that if they were going to stay in the game, if they were going to salvage anything from the cup final, then they had to get a score pretty quickly. And watch that man at the back, number 7, the skipper. And it was Dan Teague who got the touchdown. And that one certainly kept Accies in the game. The ball chipped ahead for Stevie Gordon, and taken out by Ross Brown, keeping the ball alive. Ali Dale right on his shoulder there.
Do you remember playing Big Daler in the cup final?
Yeah, Daler's just, it's such a shame that we'd lost guys like Daler and Matt Cooper had gone away for the season, because when you think back to those times, they were two of the guys that were always around, so it's a bit of a shame that they weren't part of it with us. And I think someone like Dale could have made the difference, so dependable on the line out and really mobile. Don't know what sort of nick he's in now, Dale. Last time I saw him, he's gone the other way, but he was in great shape at the time, very mobile, athletic, second row.
I remember him catching a sort of leaping back, one hand catching a ball just going down the line out, and kind of tackled him at the back of the line out, and we're lying on the ground. I was like, Canada. You never did that when you're at a Redbird place. You're just like, oh, oh, oh.
After 1 year of not eating at Bar Napoli, it turned out on the 5th of May 2007 and had an absolutely stonking game. So well done, big dealer.
Barney replaced the entire front row and we went on and we just demolished the Hawks front row. At least once. I'd like to think at least two or three times, but I'm sure it was just the surprise of having a new front row in the first one. Me, Niv and Dunkey.
My big moment came when me, Stotty and Niven came on in the second half, only for it to laugh for a brief spell before me and Niven got sucked off again with 5 minutes to go and the game lost. And Barney's reasoning was there wasn't as many scrums as he thought there would be.
Well, this theory that, you know, because he loved the fact he was rolling subs, so he could pretty much do what he wanted and he could suddenly whip off five people in a one-hour and surprise everybody and then whip them back on again when it was actually getting a bit more serious.
I mean, the pitch was too big for us. We played what we did. You know, you can score many tries, but we weren't going to beat them on tries. You know, they were all over the place. I don't think they were fitter than us. I just thought they took their opportunities better than we did.
To be honest, we were such good mates, we had such a good season, we blew some teams away. You know, we actually deserved to fucking win, really. You know, Hawks were pretty average, and I think with a couple of you know, things that could have went our way and in the final, I think we absolutely deserved to probably win, given the season we've had. And it was, you know, I think if we all could have played that game again, we would, and hopefully get a better result. But yeah, phenomenal year, always remember it.
If we played them in their backyard, we would have scalped them. So I really think we would have. And I don't think it was anything to do with the forwards losing their cool. And always blame the back. You know, the backs did it. It wasn't us. But listen, I think we probably had one eye on the PE after.
I think if we'd had a more experienced backline, with a bit of inexperience there with Gav Douglas running things at 10, but Gav on his day was unstoppable. If he wasn't on his day, he could drift out of games. If we'd had a couple more backs in that final on their game, I couldn't see us getting beat. I went into that final convinced we would win. I just thought when we get the rolling ball going, the pick and go, you just can't stop that momentum.
Right wing, but making no impression. And the Hawks defence, and just a shimmy there might have got David Rattray through, but the pass not going to hand, and the ball run out of defence by the Hawks. Long kick downfield by Ali McClay, and as the ball trickled into touch, that was a signal for referee Peter Allen to blow the final whistle. Celebrations to start in the Hawks camp, and well, you can see just how delighted they are to get their name on the cup yet again.
Remember you and I getting into a bath together afterwards?
That was actually my highlight of the day, Peter. Yeah, mm-hmm. My highlight of the day. Everyone was down in the dumps. You know, everyone was really, you know, looking forward to just winning and smashing it and getting on the spice again that we've done all year. And everyone was just, and you know, we just lapped it up. We're never going to be in here again. Let's just, we had a good year. We got in the bath together and I think we cracked open a beer.
And we used the nettle soap in them. And like, that was it. And then we went. Then we went back to RP. And I remember like big standing ovation when we came in and all those plastic Carlsbergs in the bar. And then we just got back into it again.
It was a bit of a somber feeling drinking through, you know, there was some bit of pain. But it was that standing ovation. It was pretty good.
Coming back in here, and the bar was full, getting standing ovation coming back in, which is a kind of funny thing when you lose a final, but I think it engendered what that season had been for the club and what we meant to each other that year. And I look back on it now, like it was a big moment to get to Murrayfield and lose. It's a difficult thing, but it's one of my favourite seasons I think I ever had.
It was the beginnings of the club coming back to its former glory a wee bit, and I think everyone's laughing at us celebrating a cup final dinner or a cup final reunion, but even though we lost it. But it was quite a momentous shift for the club, because the club had gone to the point where we were almost a P3 team. And we brought it back to a good P1 team. But that season in particular was the shift, the promotion, the cup run, beating all these teams. So it was a big turnaround. If that hadn't happened, and it was Barney that brought all that together, for all the criticism of him, he brought in such a good side, and it was such a bunch of kind of misfits coming together. There was the Hoik boys, a few of the academy former pupils, there was a few foreigners. It was just a real mixed bag of people that came together, and there was just such a good blend there. No one was full of themselves, everyone was just one of the boys. It was a really good mix.
Yeah, fond memories. You know, I think I've been back here now since 2008. It's coming up to 10 years, but it still feels like, maybe not yesterday, but a couple of years ago that we were running around. And you know, that year in particular was something pretty special. So I hope you boys all enjoy it. Have a couple of spices for me. And give Tubby Brown some shite.
It is brilliant. Brilliant. Glory days.
That fucking scarf.